Right. So welcome everyone who joined this webinar. My name is Sándor Kertész. I work in the development section at ECMWF and currently I'm working from home and I will present you this webinar from my study. And the topic is processing and visualizing ECMWF ensemble data. So this is the outline of the talk. We will use Jupyter notebooks, so we'll use Python, and we will use Metview's Python interface in the notebooks. I will start with showing you the plotting basics with Metview. Then the main part of the webinar will follow. It will be an introduction to ensemble data and processing and plotting. It will cover ensemble mean and spread, the stem plots, spaghetti plots, probabilities and percentiles, and finally CDF curves. And after that, I will show you a few resources which are closely related to this topic. So, we use Metview. So, what is Metview in a nutshell? It's a workstation software running on various flavors of Unix. Now it runs on Mac OS X as well. Metview is open source. It offers us visualization, data processing, and it has a nice icon-based user interface, as you can see it in the snapshots. But more importantly, it has a script language interface. It has its own language called Macro, and it has a Python interface, which we will use in the current webinar. So the forecast data that we will work with in the webinar is related to the St. Jude storm from 2013. This plot shows you the wind gust observations, and the red dots really indicate the actual storm track. All the data are in grid format. We have a deterministic forecast and ensemble forecast taken from the ENS system. Everything was retrieved from the Mars archive and post-processed with Metview. So we'll start with showing how to build a plot. And for simplicity, we will use the deterministic forecast for it. To create a plot, first we need to get the data. This is our code. It's a Jupyter notebook. In the first line, we import Metview's MV. That's the convention. It means we need to prefix all the Metview commands with the MV dot prefix. So first, we read in our grip data from the grip file using the read command. The result is a field set. Field set is Metview's own object to represent grip data. And you can imagine it as a list of grip messages, basically. You can look into the field set we created using the grip get command. It dumps the values for a few EC code keys from the grip header. We can see that we have four fields, four messages in this field set: wind gust forecast and geopotential forecast. And in the next line, using the read command again, we filter out one particular wind gust forecast step that we want to plot. This is stored in field set called FC. Next step, we define the way we want to plot our data. We define contour shading using the mcont icon. We will create a color scheme like this, in this image on the left. And then we use mLegend and then text to customize the legend and the plot title. In the next step, we define a map. First, we define a style. We will use a fancy shading. This is done via the mcost function call. And then we define the actual view using the geoView function. This function, by default, is implementing a cylindrical projection. You reset the area and set the coastline style as well. So this is how it will look in the final map. So now we have everything to create the actual plot. First, we need to call setOutput to tell Metview that the plot should be generated in the Jupyter notebook. Then we have a Jupyter notebook. We only need to call this function once, then all the plots will be automatically created in the notebook. Now the last task is just to call the plot command with all the objects we created so far. And we have the wind gust plot clearly indicating the location of the storm in the forecast. So there's something important to remark. Many of the functions we used in the example are actually representing icons from the Metview user interface. Here you see the mapping between the function names and the actual icons. The icons are quite important because when we are in the user interface, we can edit them interactively, we can drop them into a plot to change immediate style and so on. But now back to the the main topic. We now move on to the ensemble data. We store it in different grid file. The first line, we read it with the read command again. This time we only read wind gust for a given time step. This will be in field set EN. We check the metadata. We see what this field set actually contains. And here we listed the type and the number keys as well, because if you are working with ensemble data, we can have two kinds of members. These are indicated by the type key. We can have control forecast, where the type is CF, and we can have a set of perturb forecasts, where the type is PF. In this case, we have an additional key, the number which specifies this ensemble member within the ensemble forecast. And in the case of ECMWF forecast, the number goes from 1 to 50. So it means that our EN field set contains 51 fields. So now we will create a nice classic ensemble plot, a 2x2 plot with this content. So we want to have four maps in the plot, the top right, top left corner, and the deterministic forecast, then the control forecast, the bottom row, the ensemble mean, and then finally the ensemble spread. The deterministic forecast is already created because we can simply reuse what we did in the previous exercise. So we move on to the control forecast. It's very, very simple. We just call the read command again with the type key set to CF and get the field we want. We define a custom title for it. Next field we need to create is the ensemble mean. We need to compute it. We can do it with the mean function, and then view the title for it. Now the mean function is performing a point-wise aggregation. This is how the fields actually are looking like. So an EN field set contains 51 fields, and the mean for each grid point computes the mean value for only that grid point throughout all the fields, And in the end, we have only one resulting field. That's what we store in E underscore mean. The last map we need to create is the ensemble spread, which is by definition the standard deviation of the ensemble members. We can compute it with the stddev Metview function. And because the spread is a different kind of quantity than the original field, we need to create a new isoline shading that's adjusted to the current value range. And in the end, we define a title again for the spread. So we just need to put it together. First, we need to define the layout where we store the maps. We use the plot superpage command. And then, because when we work with Metview in a Jupyter notebook, we combine all the plot objects into one single plot command. We have a quite a big plot command, which is basically tells for each target map what we want to plot there. And we get in the end this very nice plot, which shows us that the forecast contains some uncertainty as the storm hit the UK. Now, one way of looking at the uncertainty in ensemble forecast is to use a stem plot. The stem plot is simple, a plot where each ensemble member is rendered into a different map, but within the same plot. So we have 51 members in this case. We need a big enough layout for it, and we use the plot superpage command to build a layout with 8 columns and 7 rows. We plot it. It really looks like a nice plot collection. Now there's just an empty plot. We need to put data into it. This is the code for it. Because now we have to deal with a lot of fields, a lot of graphical objects for the plot command. To manage it, we use the list for this task. So we define a Python list to collect all the arguments. Then we have a loop for all the perturb forecast members from 1 to 50. In the loop, we read the perturb forecast, the field set. We define a title for it, and we append all the necessary plotting objects to the list. We repeat this for the contra forecast as well. And in the end, the plot command is very, very simple because we just need to pass the list into it as an argument. And that's the plot we generated. It shows that there is indeed a variation in the location and the intensity of the storm in the forecast. Another way of looking at the individual members is a spaghetti plot. In a spaghetti plot, we are interested in a certain feature. And typically, we pick an isoline value that identifies the feature and plot only that isoline for all the ensemble members into the same map. So in this case, we selected the geopotential on 850 hectopascals. This is the deterministic forecast, and the isoline highlighted in green. This is the 125 decameter line. Gives us an indication of the location of the trough associated with this storm. So we will create a spaghetti plot for this isoline value. So we start with reading the data in. This time it's your potential on 850 hectopascals. We have it in this field EN underscore Z. Then we define two contour shadings. the contour line definitions. We use blue contours for the perturbed members. And here you can notice that in the contour level list, we have one single value, 125, which is the spaghetti value we want to look at. And we define another contour definition for the contour forecast. We want to highlight it with a thick red line in the plot. So that's the code we need to use. First, we just loop through all the perturbed forecast members and collect them into list of fields. Then we extract the contour forecast into another field, CF. So far it was easy, but then we have to be very careful with the title, because by default Metview would try to plot 51 titles into the same map, which is not what we want. So we use this very special syntax to avoid it and to generate only one plot title for a map. With this, we just need to call plot with the right set of arguments. We specify the perturbed forecast with the right contouring, the contour forecast with the right contouring, and the plot title, and we get this map, which really indicates that there was some uncertainty in the position of the trough to the west of the UK. Now, when we work with ensemble data, computing the probabilities is a very important but very basic operation. Here we will compute the probability that the wind gust is exceeding 28 meters per second. And we can do it in two lines with Matthew, but this, of course, requires some explanation. So what we do here, in the first line, we perform masking. Masking is a logical operation which turns the field values into zeros and ones based on the condition. Here, EN is a field set which contains 51 fields. And when we perform the masking in the resulting fields, prob, which again contains 51 fields, all the values will be ones or zeros based on the actual wind gust value. So then we need to perform an aggregation. The figure shows the data layout we have. So we have 51 fields, and for a given columns, we have ones, and for a given grid point, we have a series of ones and zeros. And the probability is nothing else than the relative frequency of the ones. So we need to do here a mean operation for each grid point, which we can simply do with the mean function. And this results is giving us the probabilities between 0 and 1 range, and we multiply it by 100 to get a better range for the plots. So having computed this probability field, plotting is very simple, but we first create a new contour definition for it to adjust for the current range, define a custom title, and use the plot command as before, and we get the probability map, which shows that there was indeed a very high probability of this high wind gust value in the given area. Another way of looking at the probabilities, actually on the actual distribution in the ensemble forecast, is to use a percentile map. So what it means, for example, for the 80% percentile map, the values indicate the forecast value below which 80% of the ensemble members fall. So if you want to compute it, just need to use the percent type function for it. The result is a new field set. Just define a new custom title for it, and then call the usual Metview plot command, and we have the percent time map. Closely related to the percentiles are the CDF plots for a given location. So CDF is stands for cumulative distribution function, and this plot just illustrates what it means for an actual ensemble forecast. So on the x-axis we have the forecast value range, and for a given forecast value x1, the curves gives us the probability that the forecast is less than or equal x1. To do this, we need to extract the values at a given point from the forecast. We can do it in this way. First, we define the position. This is roughly the location of Reading. We then read in the data, a given time step for the wind gust forecast, and then call Matthew's new US grid point function for this position, which will return us a NumPy array in the Jupyter notebook. And this array will contain 51 values because we've taken one value from each field. Using this, it's possible to generate a CDF plot. This is a full example. Here we will use the same location and we will generate a CDF plot for three time steps. This is how it goes. First, we define the location. We create an array called lines to store the graphical objects. Then we go through the time steps in a loop. First, we read in the data for the given time step and call Matthew's nearest grid point function to get the values into NumPy array code X. Then we use NumPy to build the actual CDF data. We define the binning, then we call NumPy's percentile function to compute the values we need. Then for simplicity, we use matplotlib to build this kind of plot object. You could have done it in Matthew as well. In this way, it's shorter. So we define a line plot object and append it to the lines list. So having finished the loop, we just need to define the legend, and we define the plot titles, axis titles, and show the plot. And this is how it looks. So with this, I finished the main part of this presentation. Just would like to show you a few resources related to the topic. Everything can be found on the Matthew page, Confluence. There's a full function documentation. All the functions we used in the examples are documented here. There's a separate page for the icons. The actual documentation for the icon functions can be accessed from this page. We have a very nice set of gallery examples now. Were 50 examples, and within this page you can find the growing collection of Jupyter notebooks. And the last one is at the bottom, is related to the webinar and whatever examples, and all the examples I showed here can be accessed in this Jupyter notebook I highlighted here. On the Matthew page, we have a lot of online materials, training courses, and tutorials. You can choose from many of these. If you want to work with Matthew, and you are on an ensemble system, it's installed on the most important platforms there, and you can access it through the module versioning system. Here on the left, you can see how to start it in an interactive or batch session, Metview itself. And on the right, you see how you start up a Jupyter notebook, which is using Metview. If you're outside the center, you can install Metview from binaries. Now, Metview is available through the Conda system as well, through the Conda Forge channel. You can build it from source, build it from the bundle, which contains all the supporting libraries, that we can, everything can be built in one go. And the Metview Python interface is an exception because it's not part of the Metview distribution, but you need to install it separately using pip. But the command is very simple, just pip install Metview. And this is just some contact information.